This is the chilling moment. Armed men storm the set of a public TV channel in Ecuador, firing off guns and waving apparent explosives during a live broadcast. The studio crew taken hostage for at least 15 minutes on air as the country watched.
That absolutely horrifying scene took place in Ecuador, where several days ago, a notorious gang leader escaped from prison. Now, his escape ended up setting off a torrent of chaos and violence in the country, which has now been basically plagued and plunged into a state of emergency as a result of that gang violence. The government is now going to war with these criminal organizations. And to be honest, it reminds me a lot of what happened in Mexico when President Calderon decided to engage in this war on drugs. He wanted to aggressively go after the Mexican drug cartels, and it really increased the bloodshed in the country. I'm hoping that won't be the case here, but let's go back to Ecuador and talk a little bit about how Ecuador got into this breaking point. Now, the country was once seen as a more peaceful than its neighbors. For instance, think about Colombia. Colombia has, you know, historically been plagued with drug gangs and drug crime. But drug trafficking gangs, unfortunately, have gained power in Ecuador as well in recent years. And to just give you an idea of how bad the situation was before this awful wave of violence, in August of last year, presidential candidate Fernando Villavicencio was assassinated after he said he received threats from Adolfo Fito Macias, the imprisoned leader of the Los Choneros, which is considered the country's most powerful gang with ties to the Sinaloa cartel. Apologies to our Spanish speaking audience for how much I might butcher names. I'm gonna do my best. Now, Fito was the gang leader who recently escaped from prison. And according to Ecuador's president, Daniel Noboa, he had received word that the government had plans to basically move all top gang leaders into maximum security prisons. And maybe that should have been the case from the very beginning, because clearly this gang leader was able to escape, and that led to another outbreak of violence. Now, the outbreak of chaos erupted after Fito went missing. Eight people were killed in Guayaquil on Tuesday, according to local police. Two police officers were also killed in the nearby city of Nobol, National Police said on X. Meanwhile, 10 people were arrested after three kidnapped police officers were freed in the southwest city of Machala, National Police said. And then earlier, police said at least seven officers had been taken captive in three cities since the state of emergency was announced. Again, I can't emphasize enough, if you go back to the war on drugs in Mexico and what that led to, I mean, very similar. You have some hardliners in government, they want to do something about the drug trade and the gang violence coming out of that trade. And as they become increasingly aggressive in finding these criminals, imprisoning these gang members, the violence kind of increases. It's like a retaliation and backlash to any government policy seeking to hold them accountable for the illegal activities that they're engaging in. At least 70 people were arrested across the whole country, police said Wednesday morning. Eight explosive devices were seized, along with 15 Molotov cocktails, nine firearms, 308 firearm cartridges, six motorcycles, and six vehicles. And look, as we previously mentioned, the president has declared a 60-day state of emergency in response to the violence. And his government has declared that 22 criminal organizations will now be considered terrorist groups that the military has authorized or has been authorized to neutralize within the bounds of international humanitarian law. Now, I like that last part. I'm always worried that the aggressive, you know, policies to bring gangs and drug criminals to justice, unfortunately, will end up harming innocent people. I mean, we've seen situations like that in countries like the Philippines, for instance. And I really hope that's not going to be the case. You have to be careful and ensure that innocent people don't get caught up in this. But yesterday, the president also stated in an interview, "We are in a state of war and we cannot give in." The military and police had apprehended 329 terrorists by Wednesday afternoon and killed five, according to the head of the Armed Forces Joint Command. His name is Jaime Patricio Vela. And as for that insanely terrifying raid that you witnessed at the very beginning of this story, the one that took place at that television station, well, thankfully and miraculously, no one was hurt. But the 13 suspects luckily were arrested. So that chaotic event, that debacle, luckily ended in the best possible way given the circumstances. And the president won his race on the promises of tackling crime in the country of Ecuador. Much of the violence in Ecuador has concentrated in the prison system, where clashes between inmates have left more than 460 people dead, many beheaded or burnt alive since February of 2021. So obviously, a big part of this needs to be reforms in their prison system. I don't think that it's enough to simply go after these gangs. I mean, they definitely should go after anyone who is causing violence, you know, breaking laws, engaging in criminal activity. Obviously, they should go after them. I'm not saying they shouldn't, but you're going to continue like reproducing this problem if you have a situation in which the prisons, you know, make these people even more brutal than they might already be, right? Like the whole point of prison isn't just to lock people in there and throw away the key forever. And obviously they're having a problem with security in their prisons as well if a gang leader is able to escape like this. So they do need to, in my opinion, reinforce the security measures at these facilities. But more importantly, and it's probably not something they're thinking about at the moment, but should, they should consider reforming these prisons so they don't breed more terrible violent behavior and crime. Now, the country's murder rate has increased significantly. For instance, it quadrupled in just a few short years from 2018 to 2022, and a record of 220 tons of drugs were seized last year. And no, this was not Coachella, this was in Ecuador. But even if the short-term violence is addressed, there are deeper systemic issues in Ecuador, as there always are, right? When you see situations like this, they don't come out from nowhere. They don't just sprout from nowhere, right? Why are there so many different drug gangs in the country? Why has violence increased? And you know, there is definitely a correlation. I'm curious to see if there's any, you know, causal relation here, but there are problems with the inequality there. Human rights groups have been complaining about some of the inequalities. For instance, Esmeraldas has seen massacres of local fishermen, bodies hanging from bridges by nooses, and rounds of car bombs going off. A normal day there is waking up and fearing that what you're hearing aren't fireworks, but gunshots. And so, you know, apparently this violence has been percolating for some while. And she also said that years of government neglect and poverty have fed the ranks of armed gangs with young people who see few options for themselves. More than additional guns on the streets, such Ecuadorians, need access to education, healthcare, and jobs. Francis Bone said, Francis Bone is from Esmeraldas, which is a human rights group. And finally, deep inequality is always going to be the breeding ground for recruiting people into criminal groups. It's very hard for someone to speak of peace and security when they're starving. You can't simply wash your hands of any blame by just saying you're going to militarize. And there's a lot of truth to that. But I think that this kind of statement really does require a little bit of nuance, right? I can't stand when you're dealing with violent criminals and you'll hear some of the more progressive minded individuals say like, no prison for this person who just like brutally beat or maimed or slaughtered someone. They just need a good job and they need healthcare and they need a home. Well, they actually need to be taken out of society for a while. And if there's any possibility in rehabilitating them, that's what should happen. But the idea that you just, you know, I like the idea of preventing criminality ahead of time by ensuring that you deal with inequality and you ensure that people have opportunities so they don't get sucked into any criminal enterprise. But I don't begrudge the government for wanting to go after violent drug gangs as they're committing violence against people living in Ecuador.
Thanks for watching the video, guys. We also love it if you hit the join button below, because that makes you a member, and members allow us to be independent, honest. We could be as progressive as we want, no corporate media influence, and that's all because of you guys. We love doing the show with our members. Hit the join button, become one of the Young Turks.